Hello everyone. So this week, how can I put it? It's extremely detailed and extremely slow work. Some of what we're about to go through may actually seem too boring for words, but sometimes we just have to make it through the really hard stuff to actually get to the fun stuff, and sounding better is always, always more fun. So I'm just going to have to ask you to trust me and to, more importantly, trust the lineage of tried and tested methods and principles of this particular exercise that we're going to go through. It has been experimented on by a huge mix of ages, of hand shapes and sizes, of mindsets and of abilities. And I personally have actually seen it have a huge impact on a wide range of violinists. So I want to just emphasize that it's not the fact of the exercise itself, but it is how you do the exercise and how you apply your mind and your physicality to the exercise. Now, if any of you want to come up with a more musical or tuneful version of this exercise that still sticks to the same principles, oh my goodness, please share it with me and please go ahead. But for now, we're just going to get to work. Good luck, guys. See you at the end. So what I would like to do is actually go back to more basics. We've covered lots of things to do with a kind of freedom of motion. So all of the exercises of trying to get you to not fear going up to higher positions and to bounce the fingers and just get a sense of comfort and familiarity with your left hand. The progression from there to actually starting to make notes. A lot of problems can arise in that moment because you start to worry about intonation, you start to actually worry about how you're going to sound, and your brain has a lot to take in. It has to start to read notes, has to worry about exactly what string you're on. There's all sorts of things that suddenly become complicated. And when your brain gets clogged and things become complicated, it manifests in your physicality, and it's really hard to stay cool and to stay relaxed and to stay calm. There's the word relaxed again. So what I thought I would do is take you through one of the most sacred, basic, and for me, life-changing exercises. It's not the fact of the exercise, it's how you approach the exercise and apply the exercise. And that is Schradieck Number 1. So this might seem like the most easy to approach basic elementary exercise, but to do it in the way that I was taught by Natasha Boyarsky and Lucia Ibrahimova is something of a challenge. It is something that takes a lot of brain power and takes a lot of concentration, and you're actually trying to infuse the exercise with a million specific little bits of information. So I'm going to take you through this exercise extremely slowly and with a lot of dialogue and a lot of stop and start. So you just have to be patient with me and trust me that it was one of four or five things that helped absolutely transform my playing, after which everything became easier. One thing I say to a lot of students that I meet of varying ages, so they could be a six-year-old that's only been playing for 1 year, or somebody that I meet that's at college, the age of 19 or 20, and is struggling with tension, with positions, with balance. I strongly recommend to them that they go back to a kind of extreme form of these basic reconnections with your hands, and that they do that for a kind of condensed period of time. It depends on your pace, it depends on how well you can focus when you practice,
It depends on your strictness with yourself to really be disciplined. For some people, I've seen this type of transformation happen over a period of 1 month. For other people, it's taken 6 months. But the basis of sound production, of feeling good and comfortable with your hands and with your arms, and the utilization of an exercise like this Schradieck Number 1, it can make your playing go from an endless array of hurdles that seem impossible to improve to something that actually feels not just manageable, but fun. So returning to all the things that we've discussed already several times, making sure that the shoulder is in a good position and feels right, making sure that this elbow is in a good place depending on which string you're going to be playing on. As you'll see, I don't have a bow. I'm holding the violin here because it just helps release that kind of pressure on this part of your body to grip hold of the instrument. So what we're going to do is not worry so much about the music. What I would advise you to do is memorize, not that it's hard, the first two bars of the Schradieck exercise. We're actually not going to go on to anything past that for now, because once you've grasped these basics, you can then apply it to the rest of the exercise. So we're just going to start with a basic principle, which is when you put down a finger, the rest should feel like they kind of bounce. So I'm just going to kind of do this in super slow motion. So we start off with this feeling of, it's like a kind of spring. And when you put down the first finger, the rest spring up. Now I'm doing this unbelievably lightly. And what you'll also see is that my first finger, when I go down and then lift it back up, it's springing up. What you'll also see is when it springs up, I'm then releasing again. There's like an instant explosion of energy and then the energy dissipates. There's lots of things that you could come up with that are good examples of that. So you think of just like an explosion of movement and then everything should just feel like jelly, really, really soft. So I'm just gonna do that exercise a few more times. So it's, you start with this feeling of the fingers just being very active but not tense from here. And what you'll see is that this entire position is zero pressure. No gripping, no pressure. My teacher Natasha, she used to say, treat the neck of the violin as if it was a pet. You would never squeeze hold of your pet, or you shouldn't anyway. she used to say, treat the violin like that. It's wood, it's sensitive, it's alive, it's an instrument, it's a work of art. So treat it very carefully. So go back to this bouncing motion and support with this hand. And then first finger up, first finger up, first finger, keep these ones nice and relaxed, up. Now we're going to go from one to two. So we go one and then two. These keep nice and free. Three, this one's bouncing. Four. And we've got all four fingers down at once. Now I'm pressing a little bit here, just a bit of grip. But this part of my hand and all over here, I'm still feeling quite supple and flexible. So I could kind of do this and do this, but I still have something of an anchor with the tips of my fingers. ¶¶ you'll see that one of the most important things for here, but for practice generally, is preparation before a movement. Now, preparation is not just get your hands in the right place and prepare your fingers. It's mental preparation so that you're absolutely in the right place, you know exactly what you have to do, and only when everything is kind of aligned, not in a kind of tense, I've got to do this movement now, wait, just in a calm way, you know exactly what you have to do, then you go for the movement and you do it with intelligence and with awareness and with a presence of mind. So now we're gonna go back down the way. So from 4 to 3, I'm waiting, 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 preparing, making sure that everything in my mind and my hand is ready to go, and then lift. Now that was not very active. So I go back down and then lift. That was a bit better. And make sure it's still relaxed, back down and then lift. And we're gonna do the same, is keep this nice and free, check the position, take your time, make sure that everything is prepared in your mind and in your hand, and then we lift. And what my teacher used to do at this point, she would stand over me and she would go like this to check that she could actually move these fingers and that they weren't stiff like that, where you couldn't move them. So she would come over and she would kind of go like this. So you can actually kind of do that to yourself, or if you have a very nice friend or a patient mother or father or sibling, they could do that. So we're on finger 2 now, and then again, prepare and lift, and then keep all of these nice and free, not gripping with the thumb. I'm still holding the violin so that it's nice and secure and steady. And then the last one, lift. And this one should feel like freedom at last. And then we can just wave about the hands and make sure they don't feel pressured. With these types of exercises, they require so much focus. It is so important to not do them for too long and to feel good when you do them. Don't come at exercises like this with a pressured mind or a stressful mind, or, oh my goodness, I've got to improve all of my violin playing technique by tonight. Like, don't be unrealistic with yourself. This is something that you have to trust me and trust the exercise. I'm just passing on what I've been told over years. These types of exercises, they develop over time and they are so attuned with things that your hand wants to do anyway. You have to trust that the exercise will, after you've done it and done it calmly and done it well, it will start to do its own work. It's like magic. And it's incredibly important that you don't practice in mistakes. So if you feel like you're not sticking to the parameters that you know are going to be best for development, then just stop. Definitely, definitely when it comes to any type of exercise that is contrary to things that you have been doing for most of your violin playing life, do not try to do them for long. And make sure your head's in the right place. Now, I saw this sort of process with people of all ages who studied with Natasha Boyarsky. One pattern I would see recur again and again and again is, regardless of the age, so this would apply to a 19-year-old as well as a 15-year-old and somebody who was like me, 10 years old when I went to study with her, she would limit your exposure to the violin. So she would discourage you from practicing 3-4 hours a day. She would absolutely discourage you from playing all kinds of challenging pieces that require all sorts of part of your brain and your emotion and your physicality. She would limit your exposure and your connection between you and the instrument to only those fundamental things that were purely healthy. And anything else that you could do, she'd rather you didn't play at all. Go and read something, or if you're young, go and play outside or study something else. Study music in another way that's not about your physical connection to your instrument. So during this sort of process of going back to those basics, you want your relationship to the instrument to be sacred. That doesn't last forever, but for a period of time, if you really want to improve these fundamentals of your physicality, more time is not more. So we're just going to show this exercise a little bit faster now, but I'm not going to be adding the bow just yet. So, same thing, bounce. This entire time in my mind, I'm also really aware of how everything else feels. So I'm like aware of my thumb. Is it in a place that's actually supportive to the most strength in my four fingers? And do I need to adjust the wrist sometimes when I go to the fourth finger? Like, I don't think I have the strongest of fourth fingers. No, I know I don't have a very strong fourth finger. So I often do need to engage my wrists to like help with the position and the strength of my fourth finger. But the whole time doing these kind of really basic exercises, I'm addressing all of those angles. Kind of like back to what Menuhin said about balance. You have to find out where your position strength is and go from that vantage point. Another thing that happens to me is when I get nervous, those types of things, like being in a position where my hand feels strong and feels like not messy, like not interfered with by a load of extraneous positions and movements, all kinds of things that are not actually helpful for my playing, they start to kind of creep in. And that is where, like, if you have a level of awareness of you don't actually need to involve your wrist when you're doing certain things, if you just believe that your fingers actually have some weight and strength. Also, all of these exercises, what they do is they tie your hand to the belief that for you to put fingers down the right place, you don't have to do this and grip and do stuff that is in the end counterproductive and exhausting and not sustainable. So I'm just going to do this a little bit faster, still extremely focused, but what I'm doing now is just relying a little bit more on a flow of movement rather than stopping and starting and kind of paranoid about each and every movement. Because at some point you have to be able to just play. You don't want to be thinking about any of these things as you're playing, and that's the point of isolating exercises. What I want to emphasize while I'm doing this is that all of that extreme movement that you see, it's not strenuous or stressful for my hand. It's actually creating like bounce and height. Because if you think about it, like if you're too close to the string all the time, you don't necessarily have quite as much weight. Now, there's something to be said for fingers not being messy and all over the place. And I'm definitely going to follow this on, and this is extremely important to emphasize, follow this on with another exercise that sort of tackles the opposite, the kind of organization and form of your left hand. And we're focusing on first position just now. So the form of the left hand, you don't want that to be something where the left hand is doing all of this like crazy stuff. That's absolutely not the point. So when you're seeing my hands doing this exercise and like going to such effort before and after each note, that is for one reason only, it's to create a bounce, it's to create a reflex, it's to create strength, it's to create a bit more height so that they can then drop down onto the string with weight. So not dissimilar to the point of this exercise. But that is a separate point to the organisation of your left hand, which should not be like four random fingers going in all directions.